Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. I'd like to invite Sarah Dunham, the Director of the Office of Transportation and Air Quality here at the EPA, to the podium.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Sarah Dunham, the Director of the Office of Transportation and Air Quality here at the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. And it is my very great privilege to be able to welcome all of you to EPA here today. It is an honor for me to be here today, because in just a few minutes, Administrator Regan will be signing the agency's final rule to cut smog and soot-forming emissions from heavy-duty trucks, beginning with model year 2027. Today's announcement is the result of a lot of hard work from the dedicated EPA staff and is a perfect example of agency professionalism in carrying out our mission. I want to thank in particular Christy Parsons, Jessica Braquera, James Sanchez, Andrea Carrillo, and Brian Nelson, who worked with colleagues across the agency under the amazing leadership of Bill Charmley. At EPA, we follow the science, we follow the law, and that is what has led us to this moment. We never forget that our job is to protect public health and the environment. And we also understand how critical it is to listen and engage with all of our stakeholders. This final rule has been significantly shaped by input from the public, including input from vehicle and engine manufacturers, parts suppliers, environmental organizations, as well as representatives from communities living near major roadways, where people of color and people with low income are disproportionately exposed to air pollution. And we have learned from our colleagues from state and local governments who have demonstrated enormous leadership in addressing emissions from this sector. President Biden and Administrator Regan have laid out a long-term vision for putting the transportation sector on a path toward zero emissions. We believe this rule announced today reflects that long-term vision and is the first step along the path toward achieving that vision. Thank you again to my colleagues in the Office of Air and Radiation and across the agency, and to Administrator Regan for leading us to this achievement. Thank you.
Please welcome Senator Tom Carper.
Good morning. Administrator Regan and Sarah, everybody else. Do we have any kids here today? If you're a kid here under the age of 40, stand up. Go ahead, stand up. All right. Come on, stand up. All right, you can sit back down. Thank you. This is, anybody celebrate Christmas? Anybody here celebrate Christmas? Anybody here celebrate Hanukkah? We just kicked off Hanukkah on Sunday. And when we think of Festival of Lights, we think of Christmas morning, we think of our unwrapping packages and finding out what's under our trees. And our boys are 32, 34, have an older son, stepson who's a bit older, has children who are off in college now. So they're kind of grown up. But we still look forward to Christmas, and we look forward to exchanging gifts. I walked out of, came down on the train this morning, as I have for God only knows how many years, but I've been privileged to be a congressman for Delaware, governor before that, and treasurer and a naval flight officer before that, but I ride the train all the time. And I get off the train and can walk through Union Station. And sometimes when I come out of Union Stations, it's raining. Sometimes it is hailing. Sometimes it is snowing. Sometimes it is sleeting. And sometimes it is a beautiful day like today, and the sun is shining, the sky is blue, and I walk out of the train station and walk right up Delaware Avenue to the Capitol, and right there at the top of the Capitol Hill is the U.S. Capitol. On top of the U.S. Capitol is the a statue of Lady Liberty. And I get to see the blue skies and the sunshine, and today, incredibly clean, crisp air. And for all the young kids here, and those of you who happen, anybody here 10, anybody here under the age of 10? Under 10, you got a 10-year-old. Anybody nine? Anybody eight? Anybody seven? Anybody six? All right. I'm tempted to call them up, but don't come. But this is a gift for you. This is a gift for you. You're going to live to be 100, maybe 200. And for all those years that you guys live, you'll have a cleaner air to breathe. And you'll have a healthier life and a better life for yourselves and eventually for your families. But that was just a riff. That was just like not in my printed remarks, which were actually were tone deaf with respect to the season. I'm going to read them anyway. But I wanted to warm you up with a little bit of humor. But hi, everybody. I am Tom Carper, United States Senator from the state of Delaware, recovering governor, and a retired Navy. I'm the last Vietnam veteran, as it turns out, serving in the United States Senate. But in addition to serving Delaware in the United States Senate, I'm privileged to serve as chairman of a committee called Environment and Public Works. And I lead that committee along with another native of West Virginia. I lead it with another West Virginia native, Shelley Capito, from the Mountain State. But this is, as we know, it's our holiday season. I'm pleased to be here with Administrator Regan and all of you today as we announce a new rule to reduce dangerous air pollution emissions from heavy-duty vehicles. The transportation sector is one of our nation's greatest sources of air pollution that contributes to deadly smog and climate pollution. And our heavy-duty vehicles, trucks, and buses make up nearly one quarter of all U.S. transportation emissions. There was a guy who used to live back in the Great Depression. He was always getting into trouble with the law. And he finally got caught, and he was dragged into court, and his name was Willie Sutton. His name was Willie Sutton. He used to rob banks. And they finally got caught, and he took him into court. And at his trial, the judge said, Mr. Sutton, why do you rob banks? And he said, Judge, that's where the money is. And why do we go after emissions from large trucks or in buses and so forth? That's where the emissions are. That's where the emissions are. All too often, our most vulnerable and underserved communities, including many communities of color, suffer the worst consequences of this air pollution. That includes higher rates of asthma. That includes higher rates of respiratory disease, and that includes, sadly, even higher rates of mortality of death. Addressing vehicle pollution is especially personal for us in the first state. Some of you didn't know who the first state was. It was Delaware. And December 7, 1787, Delaware became the first state to ratify the Constitution. And for one whole week, we were the entire United States of America. Then we opened it up. Led in Pennsylvania, New Jersey, North Carolina, and some others. And I think for the most part, it's turned out pretty well. But today, given what the administrator is going to do, it's going to turn out a whole lot better. But one of the things about our state of Delaware that we're not happy about is that we're literally at the end of America's tailpipe, with more than 90% of our state's air pollution coming from sources outside of our state. When I was governor, I could literally have shut down our state, shut down our economy, every job, every business, and we still would have been out of compliance for clean air in a number of ways. But fortunately, with the signing of this rule today, Delaware, along with other states, frontline communities around the country with unhealthy air, get a hand up. It's a gift. It is a gift from EPA, from the administrator and the team that he leads. EPA's new rules will dramatically cut dangerous pollution from our heavy-duty vehicles. That's good news for our planet, good news for our health, and as a result, good for our economy. After all, cleaner air means a healthier workforce and healthier communities. And this rule, along with the investments we made in the American Rescue Plan, which we're very proud of, the bipartisan infrastructure law, which we're very proud of, and the Inflation Reduction Act, which we're very proud of and grateful to the president for his leadership, without which none of this would have happened. But those pieces of legislation will help us move our country ever closer to achieving our clean air and our climate goals. And with Christmas only 5 days away, with Hanukkah, the beginning of Hanukkah, 2 days behind us and extending into the future, this is indeed a gift that will keep on giving. And as chairman of the Environment and Public Works Committee, I want to thank Administrator Regan. I want to thank our friends and the team that he leads at EPA for the great work that you've done on this rule. I understand there's a lot of involvement, reaching out to a lot of stakeholders to put it together. It's not just something they created in a vacuum, but with a lot of help and input. We look forward to working together as we continue to make progress toward cleaning up our vehicles and the air we breathe. In the Navy, when people do extraordinary things, they do good things for not just themselves, but for our planet, for our country, we like to say two words. The first word is bravo. Let me hear you say bravo.
Bravo.
The second word is Zulu. Let me hear you say Zulu.
Zulu.
Let me hear you say bravo, Zulu.
Bravo, Zulu.
Well done. Congratulations. Thank you.
Please welcome the Chief Mission Officer for the American Lung Association, Deborah Brown.
Good morning. I am Deb Brown, Chief Mission Officer for the American Lung Association. And thank you, Senator Carper, Mr. Administrator, and all of you for the opportunity to be here. The American Lung Association's mission is to save lives by improving lung health and preventing lung disease. And we advocate for policies that help the nearly 34 million people in this country with lung disease, and on behalf of everyone who breathes. We focus on eliminating health disparities because we know that lung disease discriminates as a result of systemic racism and environmental justice. Through our annual State of the Air report, we document the ongoing burden of air pollution in communities across the United States. The State of the Air shows that people of color and low-income communities are much more likely to experience unhealthy air. Our report documents that people of color are 3.6 more times more likely than white people to live in the most polluted air. The Clean Air Act promises air that is safe and healthy for everyone to breathe. Today's action by EPA is an important step towards this. To say these rules are a long time coming would be a big understatement. 22 years ago, December 21st, 2000, the American Lung Association joined then EPA Administrator Carol Browner inside EPA headquarters to announce the last truck cleanup rules, which were fully implemented in 2010. Today's rules are a big step forward, leveraging modern pollution controls to cut emissions on trucks in our communities, especially in neighborhoods that bear the greatest burden of deadly diesel pollution. This includes people who live and work near a highway, truck stop, port, or distribution center. We understand that these rules will cut 450,000 tons of nitrogen oxides from the air we breathe and prevent 2,900 premature deaths. This is a big deal. Trucks represent a small fraction of total on-road vehicles, but generate the greatest share of harmful air pollutants, including dangerous nitrogen oxides, or NOx. And NOx is a primary component of ozone or smog that chokes our communities. NOx forms particle pollution, too. Particle pollution is deadly, and too many communities are exposed to this pollutant at dangerous levels on an ongoing basis. Many communities have too many days with unsafe particle pollution spikes. So we appreciate the Biden-Harris administration's commitment to cleaning up vehicle pollution and driving the nation's towards zero emission transportation powered by a zero emission electric grid. We look forward to continuing to work with the EPA on the next round of truck rules, which will leverage this action and accelerate the deployment of zero emission trucks. State and federal actions to advance clean, zero-emission trucks are a life-saving step for public health and addressing climate change. Mr. Administrator, let's make December vehicle cleanup rule announcements an annual tradition. Thank you.
Please welcome the Senior Director for Strategy and Federal Policy with We Act for Environmental Justice, Dana Johnson.
Good morning. Senator Carper, this enthusiasm. I'm enjoying it. Yes. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today. As was noted, I'm with We Act for Environmental Justice, and our mission is to ensure that people living in a community of color or an area of low income have an opportunity to contribute to the decision making around policies and practices that will benefit us from a public health and an environmental perspective. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here today for the release of this new rule to decrease NOx pollution from heavy duty trucks in New York City and Northern Manhattan, where we are housed, where we are headquartered. Five of the six bus depots for the city are in our community. And so any opportunity that we have to reduce air pollution by improving our standards is much welcome. So as was mentioned by folks today, the consequences of a legacy of discriminatory land use and transportation policies in our nation has people who are living in a majority black or brown community unjustly exposed to greater concentrations of health-harming pollutants. These diesel zones, as we call them in New York, are composed of high traffic roadways and trucking routes, bus depots, goods movement facilities, and all of that results in hospitalizations, ER visits, premature death, and some of the outcomes that the two speakers before me shared with you. This year, we wanted to leverage the opportunity that the EPA presented in updating rules, quite frankly, across a couple of sectors. And we formed what we call the Clean Air for the Long Haul cohort. And in September, this group of people did focus groups in their communities. And what they essentially confirmed, I think, is that the concerns and preferences of people of color really demonstrate how crucial this EPA rule will be to advance strong standards that will minimize pollution from the heavy-duty truck sector. So we see today's announcement as a first step in a set of rules that can further reduce pollution as we transition to cleaner fleets across all categories of vehicles in this nation. We see this as the unlocking of an opportunity that we get to implement at the state level. And we look forward to continuing to work with the EPA to ensure that future rules are strong, they address pollution, and we have a special affinity for successful implementation of the Clean School Bus Program, heavy duty and port programs that are funded through the infrastructure package and the Inflation Reduction Act. We see those as being crucial to transitioning to zero emission technologies, and they will ensure that our communities are healthy, vibrant places for generations to come. Thank you.
Please welcome the Legislative Director for the United Automobile, Aerospace, and Agricultural Implement Workers of America, Josh Nasser.
Thanks. Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing today? This is really a great day because I want to first of all thank Administrator Regan, but also the President, President Biden, for always making sure that workers have a seat at the table. It's not just rhetoric, it's true with this administration. And I think that really needs to be acknowledged. Thank you. I also want to just acknowledge that this was really a team effort. This is a difficult task that's being achieved here, and that really took a lot of hard work from an awful lot of people, including the dedicated career staff at EPA, who, you know, some people will sometimes vilify and malign. I think that's really wrong. They're really hardworking folks who are trying to do the right thing. So I think they should be acknowledged too. So thank you. But also the stakeholders as well. I mean, it should be acknowledged that the industry, that the OEMs, and our members, we represent, we over a million members, retirees, tens of thousands who work building the trucks that you see here today. And they work for companies such as Volvo, Daimler, Navistar, and others. And they want to build the vehicles of the future. And we believe that we know that it's possible to have a win-win that's good for the environment and good for workers. And we think that that's being achieved here today. And we're going to work carefully on the with the stakeholders, EPA administration, on the implementation. But I think it needs to be acknowledged that climate change is absolutely here. I mean, there's no doubt about it. And this false choice between being good for the economy, good for workers, or good for the environment, we got to do away with that false choice. It's not only bad for the environment and that idea that it's one or the other, it's actually ultimately bad for workers, because we will fall behind, and we will not make the vehicles of the future if we ignore the realities of the marketplace and the climate. And the other thing is that we really got it. These vehicles have to be purchased in order to really make a difference. We have to get the older trucks off the road, and people have to buy the newer trucks. And that's why the affordability is really important, and you got to really find that sweet spot. A high standard where that doesn't achieve changes within the industry doesn't really get us anywhere. So really a fine line needs to be walked, and we believe today that's been achieved. We're just really honored to be here today, we really look forward to continuing this progress. This is an industry that's made a lot of progress, and there's more to be made, and I think working together we can show that progress can be made. light duty regs were finalized a year ago. Now we got this here today. Real results are being made for, which is good for workers, good for the country, and good for the planet and our future. So thanks, it's really an honor to be here today.
Please welcome from Mom's Clean Air Force, Arandi Trevino and Mayela Bustos.
Good morning. My name is Arandi Trevino, and standing next to me today is my mother, Mayela Bustos. We are members of Moms Clean Air Force and its Latino engagement program, Ecomadres, where I serve as the Texas State Coordinator. As clean air advocates, we work within our communities to protect our children from air and climate pollution because we all deserve to breathe clean air and live in a safe environment. My family lives in a multi-generational home in Houston, Texas, a city known to have poor air quality due to the Houston Ship Channel, heavy industry, numerous oil refineries, and freight routes. Our home in Houston is surrounded by an 18-wheeler parking lot, a demolition company, a crating company, and a small road that sees constant movement from heavy-duty trucks all day. Every day I hear the trucks and I see the traffic and I hear the idling, and sometimes we can even smell and taste it. Our experience is far from uncommon. People living in low-income communities and communities of color are more likely to live near truck routes, bearing the brunt of emissions from these vehicles. Living near heavy-duty truck pollution is taking a toll on our health. My youngest niece is 4 years old and has severe allergies and breathing problems that often disrupt her sleep. My mother and I both have fibromyalgia and a series of other chronic conditions that are made worse by pollution. Diesel emissions have been linked to other serious health issues like heart disease and lung cancer. As someone all too familiar with the health impacts of truck pollution, today's release of the final rule to reduce harmful nitrogen oxide emissions from heavy-duty vehicles resonates deeply with me. This rulemaking is deeply personal for me and for many other families. It is a recognition that sacrificial zones such as my home, such as Southeast Houston, and such as many other communities around the country are not acceptable. And it is a recognition that my family's health is a priority. I applaud the EPA Clean Trucks Plan for strengthening protections against deadly truck pollution, and I look forward to even stronger protections for our health in the coming years. Thank you.
Please welcome to the podium, Zara Halaki.
Hello, everybody. I'm Zara Halaki. I'm a 10-year-old fifth grader at Oyster Adams Elementary School here in Washington, D.C. I'm excited to be here today and so happy that the EPA is taking another step in the fight against air pollution and climate change. Tailpipe pollution from buses and trucks is dangerous for kids' health and terrible for the environment. I understand this personally because I have asthma. My asthma was much worse when I was living in a different country with more pollution and fewer regulations. But even in the United States, many children suffer from asthma and other health conditions because they live in communities that are close to freight routes and highways with hundreds of trucks driving by their neighborhoods every hour. Too often, people in vulnerable communities don't have the resources to move to places with better air quality. This environmental injustice happens even though everyone deserves to breathe clean air. This is why addressing tailpipe pollution is a great first step, but we can't stop here. As the late Kenyan professor and environmental activist Wangari Maathai once said, we should be hummingbirds. The hummingbird might be small, but it works hard and tries the best it can. We should all do the best we can. My friends and I are doing the best we can. We started a climate club at our school, we attend rallies and marches, and we talk to our friends about climate change and environmental justice. We're calling on the EPA and all adults to do the best they can to fight against climate change with urgency. Thank you, Administrator Regan, and everyone who's doing what they can to make sure our future is bright and healthy. Now it's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, EPA Administrator Michael Regan.
Thank you, Zara, for that wonderful job. As you were speaking, Senator Carper whispered to me and said, "I'm glad I don't have to follow her." Senator Carper, it's so good to be with you today. You know, I almost didn't recognize him today. The last few times I've seen him, he's had on a tuxedo and he cleans up pretty well. So I can honestly say without Senator Carper's partnership with the president, EPA would not be in the shape that it's in. So Senator, thank you so much for your dedication. Yes. I'm also grateful to the leaders who are here with us today from the American Lung Association, Moms Clean Air Force, WEAC, and the United Auto Workers. It is because of your collective work and advocacy that we benefit from a healthier, cleaner, and safe environment. So I want to let you all know we appreciate you. The trucks behind me are amazing. Thank you to the manufacturers Daimler and Volvo who provided the vehicles, and I want to thank the amazing EPA team who made this tremendous event possible. When I stepped into this role as administrator over 2 years ago, I committed to the people that I committed that all people would be protected from environmental hazard and harm and prioritizing those who are most at risk. Everyone in this country, regardless of the color of their skin, the money in their pocket, or the community that they live in, deserve clean air to breathe, clean water to drink, and the opportunity to live, work, and thrive in a healthy environment. And polluted air and toxic emissions are undeniably a detriment to that opportunity. An estimated 72 million people, often people of color or people with lower incomes, live near freight routes in America. These communities are overburdened and disproportionately exposed to pollution from heavy-duty vehicles, resulting in adverse health challenges, including respiratory and cardiovascular illness. Environmental justice centers all of our agencies' work, and we're here today to highlight one way EPA is working to create a cleaner, healthier, and more just future for everyone. I'm so proud to announce that EPA has finalized the strongest ever national standards that will reduce smog and soot-forming nitrogen oxide emissions from heavy-duty vehicles and engines. Because of our collective work, this rule will result in widespread air quality improvements across the United States, especially in communities near major roadways that are overburdened by air pollution. The standard will begin with model year 2027 and is the first comprehensive national nitrogen oxide standard for heavy-duty trucks and engines in more than 20 years. This rule is historic, and it's a game changer for people all across this country. EPA engaged with a variety of stakeholders, including impacted communities, tribal, state, and local governments, environmental justice organizations, labor groups, to deliver the most ambitious standards swiftly and in accordance with the law. These national standards are as strong as possible, will take effect as soon as possible, and will last for as long as possible. And the benefits of this action will exceed its cost by billions of dollars, saving lives, reducing emergency room visits, and preventing days lost at school and work due to illness. But folks, this is only the beginning. This rule is the first of three very important steps in EPA's Clean Trucks Plan that will pave the way to a zero emissions future. By the end of March in 2023, EPA will propose the next critical step in the Clean Trucks Plan to address climate pollution. And thanks to the leadership of President Biden and my colleagues in Congress, through unprecedented resources from the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law and the Inflation Reduction Act, we will work to overhaul our nation's heavy-duty truck fleet for the next generation. While EPA standards will push heavy-duty trucks to be cleaner, this administration's investments in cleaner trucks and cleaner technology will propel us further and faster than ever before. I'm incredibly grateful to all who helped us get to this moment. Thank you to EPA's phenomenal career staff who played a role in pushing us through to the finish line. And you all have worked around the clock, especially over the last few weeks, and the people of this country are much better off because of your dedication. Today marks a historic win for public health, for the environment, and for the future of our nation. Zero emission vehicles can and will be the American standard, and I'm excited that we're all hitting the accelerator together. Now, let's sign this rule.
Are we ready?
Yeah.
All right. All right. Thank you, sir.